Hi everyone, this is topic 14b, digestive system. We are continuing with that. This is the second lecture of the two lectures in digestive system. We have covered up to small intestine in the previous part, and in this part we are going to start with the large intestine. The large intestine is called so because it is larger in diameter, not that it is longer in length. So it is about 3 inches in diameter, while the small intestine is only 1 inch in diameter. The length of the large intestine is 5 feet, whereas that of the small intestine was 11 to 15 feet. So it starts from the ileocecal valve, which is present at the junction between the small intestine and the large intestine. And it goes all the way up to the anus, from which food is defecated out. The subdivisions of large intestine include the cecum, appendix, colon. Colon includes ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and sigmoid colon. Rectum, and finally the anal canal that opens to the exterior through the opening called anus. This figure illustrates the subdivisions of the large intestine. You can see that it starts with the cecum. At the junction of the cecum and the small intestine is the ileocecal valve. The name is ileocecal because ileum comes from the last part of the small intestine, and cecal is for the cecum, which is the first part of the large intestine. Near the cecum, you see appendix, which is a blind end. It's part of lymphoid tissue. Then on the other hand of the cecum is the ascending colon, which is going up. The ascending colon would then start traveling horizontally, which is the transverse colon. Then the colon moves downwards, which is the descending colon. It makes an S-shaped turn, that is sigmoid colon. Then it opens into the rectum, which is just a muscular tube, and the rectum would open into the anal canal. The anal canal has two controlling mechanisms, the external and the internal anal sphincters. So we are going to learn about each subdivision of the large intestine. Cecum is the first sac-like part, and its function is reabsorption of water and salts. It also lubricates the chyme, which has come out from the stomach and the small intestine. It keeps adding mucus to it so that the feces that is being formed is slippery, it's not too dry. Second, appendix, which is a blind end, it's accumulation of the lymphatic tissue. Sometimes it becomes inflamed, and then it's known as appendicitis. It is hanging from the cecum, and main function is it is a reservoir of very useful beneficial bacteria that live in your gut. The colon has four parts. The first part is the ascending colon, where the colon is traveling up on the right side of the abdomen. Then is the transverse colon, where the colon travels horizontally across the abdominal cavity to the other side. Third is descending colon, where the colon is traveling down to the left side. The descending colon, it then makes an S-shaped region, which is the sigmoid colon, and the sigmoid colon, it enters the pelvis. The sigmoid colon opens into the rectum, and the rectum opens into the anal canal, which would open to the outside through the anus. The large intestine opens to the outside through the anus. The anus has two controlling mechanisms. The external anal sphincter, which is made up of skeletal muscle, so it is voluntary in nature, and the internal anal sphincter, which is formed of smooth muscle, so it is involuntary. These sphincters are usually closed, and they open only during defecation. Continuing with large intestine anatomy, there are no villi present inside the large intestine. The goblet cells are special type of cells that produce alkaline mucus, and this mucus helps in lubricating the feces, and thus it helps in the smooth passage of feces. The muscularis externa here is reduced to only three bands of muscles, which are called tuberculi. The function of tuberculi is to cause the formation of pocket-like structures known as hostra. These hostra give the colon its characteristic segmented appearance. What is the function of hostra? Hostrum helps in the transformation of solid waste into feces by mixing it with the bacteria that are present inside the large intestine and mucus. So the hostra increase the surface area and also help in water reabsorption. Look at the puffed jacket-like appearance of the large intestine. Those pouches are known as the hostra, singular is hostrum. We are done with the organs of the alimentary canal, and now we are going to learn about the accessory digestive organs. These include the teeth, salivary glands, pancreas, liver, and gallbladder. Teeth. Human beings have two sets of teeth. The function of teeth is to start the mechanical digestion of food, which is mastication. The first set of teeth that human beings get are known as the deciduous teeth or the baby teeth or the milk teeth. These are 20 in number and they usually appear by the age of 2. Then the deciduous teeth get replaced by the permanent teeth. The permanent teeth are stronger and bigger and usually they replace the deciduous teeth between the ages of 6 and 12. A full set of permanent teeth include 32 teeth, but some people would not get until, you know, very late in adulthood or may never get the third molars, which are commonly known as the wisdom teeth. And if the wisdom teeth do emerge, they could, you know, appear anytime between 17 and 25, and they usually give people trouble, a lot of tooth pain because of their orientation. They may not be properly placed, there may not be enough space in the jaw for the teeth. Classification of teeth. There are four types of teeth present in the permanent set. The first one is incisors, which are for cutting. The second one are the canines, which are required for piercing or tearing the food. The third type of teeth are the premolars or the bicuspids, which are for grinding. And finally, the last one are the molars, which are also for grinding. The dental formula is written as 2, 1, 2, 3. So if you take any, you know, either the upper jaw or the lower jaw, so there would be 2 incisors, 1 canine, 2 premolars and 3 molars on one side, and the similar, exactly same, 2, 1, 2, 3 on the other side also. So if you multiply this 4 times, 2, 1, 2, if you add 2 plus 1 plus 2 plus 3 and then multiply with 4 times, you get a 32 teeth inside the oral cavity. Salivary glands and saliva. There are 3 pairs of salivary glands inside the oral cavity. The first pair is parotid glands, which are found anterior to the ears. The second and the third pairs are submandibular and sublingual glands. In both of these salivary glands, they empty the saliva into the floor of the oral cavity through small ducts. What is saliva? Saliva is a mixture of mucus and serous fluids. And when saliva mixes with food, it forms bolus, and thus it helps, it is easier to swallow food. Saliva also contains enzymes such as the salivary amylase enzyme that helps in the chemical digestion of starch. And there are chemicals such as lysozyme, which help in protection against bacteria and also releases the taste. This figure shows the location of the 3 types of salivary glands. Pancreas plays a very important role in the digestive system. It is a fish-shaped spongy organ about 6 inches long. And this is a mixed gland. That means it has both exocrine and endocrine function. The exocrine part of the gland secretes a variety of digestive enzymes, which would break down all the different types of food. And these enzymes are released into the duodenum. There's also an alkaline fluid that comes out from the pancreas and it neutralizes the acidity of the chyme that comes out from the stomach. The endocrine part of pancreas secretes 4 hormones, but the 2 main hormones being insulin and glucagon, which lower the level of glucose in blood and elevate the level of glucose in blood respectively. This slide shows the pancreas. Liver is the largest gland in the body, located on the right side of the abdominal cavity under the diaphragm. It consists of 4 lobes and is suspended from the abdominal wall by a ligament called the falciform ligament. It is connected to the gallbladder via the common hepatic duct. So bile is made in the liver and it gets stored in the gallbladder. And the common hepatic duct joins the cystic duct to form the bile duct that would open into the duodenum. This diagram shows the liver and the gallbladder. Bile is a greenish to yellowish brown fluid which is produced by the cells in the liver. So it is produced by the liver, but it gets stored in the gallbladder and it is discharged into the duodenum by the bile duct. It is made up of bile salts, bile pigments such as bilirubin or biliverdin, and also cholesterol, phospholipids, electrolytes. The function of bile is fat digestion. It emulsifies fat by breaking it down into small particles. The gallbladder is a small sac-like structure which is found in the hollow fossa of the liver, and this serves as a temporary reservoir for bile. When no digestion is occurring, then bile would back up the cystic duct and would stay in the gallbladder. When digestion of fatty food is occurring, then bile would be discharged into the duodenum from the gallbladder. You frequently hear of gallstones. Gallstones are actually crystallized cholesterol that can cause blockages and can be painful. This figure shows the gallbladder and the liver. This is a summary of all the digestive organs with their functions, the parts of the alimentary canal. A little bit about chemical digestion. We know that food is chemically digested with the help of enzymes, and they would break down the food molecules into their building blocks. So carbohydrates would be broken down into simple sugars, and the chemical digestion of carbohydrate begins inside your mouth in the oral cavity. The salivary amylase enzyme helps in this. Proteins would get broken down into amino acids. Chemical digestion of protein begins in the stomach with the help of pepsin enzyme. While fats are broken down into fatty acids and alcohols, and these fats would get absorbed by lymphatic capillaries, the lacteals. The digestion and absorption of fat occurs mostly in the duodenum with the help of bile from the liver and digestive enzymes from pancreas. Nutrition is important. We know that nutrient is any substance that is used by the body for its growth, for its repair or maintenance. The major nutrients required by the body include carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and water, while minor nutrients are vitamins and the minerals. This is a food pyramid showing you the portion sizes of grains, veggies, fruits, oils, and other food components. Dietary sources of major nutrients. Carbohydrates usually come from plants. Okay, some animal sources of carbohydrates would be lactose or small amounts of glycogen from meats. Lipids can be saturated fats or unsaturated fats. Cholesterol from egg yolk is a source of lipids or fat. Milk products are also lipid sources. Proteins are two types, complete and incomplete proteins. Complete proteins would be those that contain all the amino acids that are essential for our body, and most of these come from animal products. What are essential amino acids? It is those amino acids that our body cannot make, so we have to obtain these amino acids from our food. Vegetarian sources of proteins such as legumes and beans also have proteins, but these are incomplete proteins. They do not provide all the essential amino acids. So that's why we need a good combination of different types of legumes and beans. Vitamins and minerals can be obtained from different types of food, from fruits and vegetables, and they play many important roles in the body. Cholesterol. There are functions of cholesterol in the body. First, this serves as the starting material for all steroid hormones and vitamin D. Second, this is a component of the plasma membrane in each and every cell. Please remember that most cholesterol is produced in the liver, about 85%, and is not from the diet. We get only 15% of the cholesterol from our diet. Cholesterol transport. Cholesterol and fatty acids, usually they cannot freely move around in the bloodstream. They need a ride. And that ride is provided by lipoproteins, which are complexes of lipid and proteins. There are two types of lipoproteins. The low density lipoproteins, which transport cholesterol to the body cells. So these are considered bad lipoproteins since they can cause blockage in your arteries or atherosclerosis. While high density lipoproteins or HDLs are considered good lipoproteins because they transport cholesterol from body cells to the liver.